Good morning, Grace. It is a delight to have you with us this day for worship, for prayer, for music, for meditation and reflection. My name is Kama Hamilton Morton. I am the senior pastor here at Grace United Methodist Church in South Denver. You can find us on Facebook or YouTube at Denver Grace UMC. We are glad that you are with us, whether it is the Sunday 10 o'clock hour or any other hour of the day. The blessing of being online means that we can connect at various times in people's lives. We will continue to be online for the foreseeable future, and so we ask, we just pray blessings upon you wherever you find yourself and invite you to this time of worship together.
To you right now. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredulity. It was the season of light, it was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. The book tells the time of chaos, conflict, and despair, as well as a time of joy, hope, and happiness. It's pretty weird that a book that was written so long ago is describing what we are experiencing right now. These are tough times for many. Many who have gotten sick, many who have lost their lives, including some of our own church members, some who have lost their jobs, some who are worrying about feeding their families. But in the midst of all this craziness, we hear the stories of hope, of bravery, of support, of strength, of humor, and of appreciation. The Bible scripture that will be read after this tells of a time of worry and anxiety. Jesus is talking to his disciples who are troubled. It's shortly before Jesus is killed and the disciples are worried about losing him. Jesus tells them he will not leave them. Even though they won't be able to see him, he will still be with them always and forever. Through these words in the Bible, God is telling us the same thing. He is with us during the best of times and the worst of times. His unending love lives in us always. In times of difficulty and trouble, it is a blessing to realize that God loves us and cares about us no matter what. Jesus promises us that he and God will always be with us, and he reminds us that his love should be appreciated and shared. Through the comfort of the Holy Spirit, we are given a way to have his presence here. Like these fur babies bring me comfort, thinking that it's you by my side, Jesus and God tell us they are comforting us again through the best times and the worst times. So if you could pray with me like we normally do, where you repeat after me, Dear God, while we don't know what is going to happen next, we know that you do. Thank you for being with us always, during the good times and the bad. Help us feel the comfort of your love and share that love with others. Amen. Love you.
Our scripture today is from John chapter 14, verses 15 through 21. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me, because I live. You also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. Here ends our reading.
Thank you, Reverend Mary, for sharing that scripture from the Gospel of John. I encourage you, if you have a Bible at home, to look in that New Testament Gospel of John. Chapters 14 through 17 are a long speech that Jesus gives. This is after Maundy Thursday. This is in the very last hours of his life, and he is with his beloved community, his disciples. And he gives them in John a long talk, and it is called the Farewell Discourse. So I invite you to look it up, John chapters 14 through 17, and that's what we are delving into today. Last week we started with In My House or Many Dwelling Places, If It Were Not So, Would I Not Come to You? And Jesus is giving his disciples a picture of connection beyond life and of depth of relationship. And also, when Jesus says you in the text, this is not you as an individual. He is saying y'all. He's saying the plural of you, which is y'all in community. Maybe he was from Texas originally. I don't know. But he uses these themes and images that keep going around, coming and going, believe, know, see, remain, love. And in our text for today that Reverend Mary read, Jesus is trying to prepare his disciples for his leaving. And he wants them to know, first, that their love of Jesus will be made known through their actions. In fact, more than that, in the text today, Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And then later he says, "They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. Those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." What are these commandments? We're not talking about the Ten Commandments. We're not talking about a big long list of do's and don'ts. But a chapter earlier, on part of our Holy Thursday or Maundy Thursday text from John chapter 13, Jesus says, "I give you a new commandment. Love one another. Just as I have loved you, now you must love one another. By this, others will know that you are my followers, if you love one another." That's the commandment that Jesus calls his disciples, calls us to live out, to show the world that we are, in fact, striving to follow after the example of Jesus. Whoa. So that's the first thing he wants to leave them with. He says it twice. If you love, you'll keep my commandments. And their love will be known through their actions. Secondly, even after Jesus is gone, the community will not be alone, but will be sustained. And he introduces this advocate, this comforter, this Holy Spirit that will remain in them and be with them always. And so may this text be a word of invitation and challenge and comfort for us as well this day. When archaeologists are doing digs around the world, especially around ancient burial sites, they will sometimes find seeds left with the dead that are intended in some cultures to grow food in the afterlife. It's found all over the world. And amazingly, people have found that if they take some of these seeds and give them some nourishment, even thousands of years later, they can sprout and bear fruit. A little nourishment is all they needed. They will grow with the proper conditions of light, water, and food. So, my friends, on this sixth Sunday in the Easter season, as we are moving through the spring and preparing for the traditional American holiday season, which begins next weekend, are you nourishing the seeds in your life, your relationships, your hopes? What are those seeds that are within you? Because God seeds in each of us possibilities, hopes, dreams, visions, talents, graces, opportunities. And nourished by our attention and cooperation, those seeds can grow. But I don't know about you, but sometimes I don't nurture the seeds of possibility or grace or new life or potential. We can nurture other things instead. We can nurture impatience or holding a grudge or being unfaithful in the way that we live ourselves, or littleness, or just belittling others. We can nurture smallness as much as we can nurture the seeds that God plants in us. We write ourselves off. "Oh, I blew that chance. Well, after an experience like that, I'm not going to trust them again." Or, "I'm a victim of," and you fill in the blank. Abuse, addiction, poverty, the government, our parents, the economy, my appearance, a world that doesn't care, a society that devalues women and persons of color, a nation that praises the wrong, unhealthy kind of success, and a universe that just seems unfriendly at times. I may never have what it takes to be happy. But those seeds are within you. The promise and the invitation never goes away. They can get covered up with layers of disappointment or rejection or resignation, but if we can pause and think about it and dig a little inside of ourselves and perhaps find those seeds and nurture them, we may find that God, that same God in whose life you draw your own breath and life, is at the center of your being and calling you to something transformative. What if we could begin to open ourselves to the greater truths about our lives? What if we could begin each day with a little prayer thought? Who I am is greater than, fill in the blank. Who I am is greater than this hurt. Who I am is greater than the problems before me. Who I am is never alone. But sometimes there can feel like a chasm between who we really are, who we've been created to be, and who we believe ourselves to be. The person we've accepted as ourselves can sometimes be based on our past or what we've been told about ourselves by others. Anybody else have messaging, have those tapes in your head that kick in every now and again? They can go back an awful long time and still have power over us, can't they? We adopt the belief that we're not good enough, that something is missing. But the message of Jesus to his disciples rings just as true for us today. I will not leave you orphaned. I am in God, you in me, and I in you. It's kind of confusing. But it's a metaphorical language meant to connect us beyond our understanding to a depth of connection and relationship and engagement with the very God of the universe. Can we feel that presence today? Can we stop, breathe, ponder, open ourselves up? Can we know that Christ is with us and in us and moving through us? You and I, we are heirs of those disciples who first heard the voice of Christ and who followed. We, my brothers and sisters, we are called to look inside of ourselves and to find those seeds of the holy which have been planted there. May we lean into a new week with a conviction that you can make a difference. We can make a difference to ourselves, to our families, our church, our community, and our world. And the world needs you. Your neighborhood needs you. There are people hurting and hungering, literally today, that need us in our presence of extending the face of Christ to others. Seeds are planted in you. What might be waiting to sprout with just a little nourishment? God, the creator of the universe, Christ, the redeemer of all, they are in you. They abide with you. And if we are mindful and a little attentive, we just may find healing and wholeness and unity with Christ, with God in our midst today, tomorrow, the next day. What might that gift look and feel like to extract ourselves and free ourselves from the burdens of the messaging and the tapes and the shame and the fear, and to open ourselves up to the light and the life and the fierceness and the work and the call and the invitation and the love that Jesus has for each of us. As I reflected on this text this week, there was an old hymn that popped into my mind that is used for in a lot of funerals, but also a popular requested hymn in many faith communities. And so I'd like to share a little bit of it. It is called Abide With Me. So if you can think of the scripture and these themes of God with us with Jesus, Jesus with God, Jesus with us, that we are all abiding in and with each other. Abide with me. Fast falls the eventide, the darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, oh, abide with me. Swift to its close ebbs out life's little day. Earth's joys grow dim, its glories pass away. Change and decay in all around I see. O thou who changest not, abide with me. I need thy presence every passing hour. What but thy grace can foil the tempter's power? Who, like myself, my guide and stay can be? Through cloud and sunshine, Lord, abide with me. My brothers and sisters, no matter how you picture God, as a father and a mother, a friend, a companion, no matter what you call God, or Jesus, or Christ, the holy creator, sustainer, may you strive to connect consciously, mindfully to God. And may we all grow to know. May you know within yourself, within your being, that you are precious, that you are endowed with the seeds of God's presence and work, and that you have more than enough. You have more than enough ideas, more than sufficient inspiration, an abundance of internal resources to strengthen, to meet your days and your circumstances. And there are difficult days and circumstances to meet, are there not? You don't have to earn or perform to connect with God. The connection is yours because you are a child of God. You don't have to adopt a different identity in order to be perfect or deserving. Your identity as a child of God is not earned. It's a gift that lies in your hands and is seated within you. We call it grace. And may you look for and identify and just ponder, even if you can't identify, ponder about those seeds that God has placed within you. May we receive this invitation from Jesus's 14th chapter this day, from John's 14th chapter, the words of Jesus calling us and reminding us that Jesus leaves us with all that we need. And for all of us that face deep hurts, troubles, stumbling blocks, complexities, and trials in our everyday lives, may we know that we are not alone, that we are not only held in grace, but that the Lord of all creation, that the Christ who comes and lives in the world, abide in and through and with us this day. God abides with you. May you receive the gift. And then, as a follower of Jesus' commandments, may you go forth to love and serve. Amen. I invite you to take a breath as we pray together. And this day, I'm aware that so many people, so children and youth and adults, are in a season of graduation. This Sunday, we would normally be lifting up Sunday school teachers and kids as they move from one stage of education to another in the church or in their schools. And I have people in my life, family members and friends, who are graduating from one thing in life to another. So I would invite us to breathe deep, knowing that God is abiding with us through this season. And let us pray. God of truth and knowledge, by your wisdom, we are taught your ways. Bless all of those, children, youth, and adults, as they finish their course of study. We thank you for those who taught and worked beside them, all who supported them along the way. Walk and abide with all graduates, that they may move forward in life. Take away their anxiety and any confusion. Strengthen their many talents and skills. Instill in them a confidence that they can identify and know that you have seeded them with so much. May their energies be gathered up and used for the good of all people, as Jesus' commandment sends us out to love one another. We pray this for the sake of and in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Grace United Methodist is a church in mission, extending itself as a presence of Christ to those in our congregation, our neighborhood, our community, and beyond. And this morning I would lift up a mission that we have been connected with for years. It is in the inner city of Denver, located on 14th and Pearl, and it is called the Network Coffee House. Network Coffee House. If you go to their website, it's just amazing to hear what all they are doing. They are a ministry of welcome and hospitality to those without homes. And it is a very intentional relationship-building ministry. In this season, a lot of the agencies and resources that are available in typical times are not as readily available. So we have a presence from Grace that is connecting directly with the network that I would invite you to consider supporting. We have Monday through Saturday, the Network Coffee House distributes sack lunches and coffee to folks individually and in social distancing. And we have two families, Karen Sumner, Karen and Jan, and Lee McClure and her family, that have been the physical bodies taking sack lunches down and helping to distribute them. So we're inviting people to help participate. If you have either financially or with sack lunch items that you can bring by the church, or give us a call and we will be glad to help funnel gifts to that. That's a 6 day a week thing. And between the two women, they are covering 3 to 4 days of that week. In addition, on Sunday, the house is closed. And so Karen and Jan have taken it upon themselves to go to the tented area where many of those without homes are able to be, and to bring, again, lunches to as many people as they have food to give. So if you would like to be a part of this life-changing ministry of wholeness and hunger and life and generosity, then we invite you to support the work of Grace and to extend through sack lunch items in that way. So we give great thanks for the generosity of these families and that they are allowing us as a church to be present with some of the most vulnerable in our community.
Living, it is in Christ Jesus, and when we're dying, it is in the Lord. Both in our living and
And now let us go from this place. In our scripture today, Jesus says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." And later he says, "They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me." And those commandments are, from John 13, to love one another. Jesus says, "Just as I have loved you, love one another." This is how people will know you are my follower. Not by just what you say, not by wearing a Christian t-shirt, not by any external thing, but if you have love for one another, that will be evidence that you are a follower of mine. So, friends, may we receive the invitation of God to abide with us this week. May we look for those seeds of potential and possibility that might be dormant within us, but with a little mindful attention and nourishment might sprout something beautiful. You are gifted and beloved of God. May we go forth this week as if we believed it. Thanks be to God. Amen.